Hello and welcome, esteemed members of the practical and master class. The previous video highlighted the benefits of flavo injections in the treatment of central and foraminal stenosis. However, this does not mean that transforaminal steroid injections are unnecessary. In my previous study, I compared the outcomes of bilateral transforaminal and facet joint injections. While I previously emphasized the direct advantages of flavo injections, one key factor that sets flavo injections advantage is their technical ease in delivering steroids accurately to the target site, especially in cases of severe stenosis or spinal deformities. This higher technical success rate of delivering medication to the target area might increase the immune suppression rate of the target immune or inflammatory cells because the transforaminal administration can frequently pose challenges in achieving precise steroid placement due to the narrowed foraminal space. However, transforaminal injections offer distinct advantages. First, they are highly effective in treating herniated nucleus pulposus or discogenic pain. Second, the needle can mechanically dilate the foraminal tunnel during the insertion and manipulation, creating more space for nerve root gliding. Third, a high concentration of dextrose injection during a transforaminal injection can extract water from the immune cells and sensory nerve tissue, cause transient shrinking, and reduce edema. This mechanical benefit is unique to the transforaminal approach. As such, I love to use transforaminal steroid injections for specific indications. In fact, depending on the pathological condition, I often combine the transforaminal route with flavo injections in the same patient. This decision is guided by carefully interpreting MR images to tailor the treatment to the individual's condition. Moving forward, I aim to further investigate the mechanical benefits of transforaminal injections beyond their role in delivering steroids to the target. Please stay tuned for more insights. I will begin with the basic anatomy of the intervertebral foramina before talking about the mechanical advantage of transforaminal injection. When viewed from outside to inside, the foraminal space resembles a peanut shape, with its upper and lower boundaries formed by the pedicles and its anterior boundary by the intervertebral disc and vertebral body. The facet joint and ligamentum flavum define the posterior boundary. The intervertebral foramen is a passage for critical neurovascular structures, including the spinal nerve, sinovertebral nerve, spinal artery, and intervertebral vein. It is important to recognize the typical locations of each structure within the foraminal space, as they are generally consistent. However, variability may occur due to degenerative changes such as disc herniation, stenosis, or osteophytes. In cases of foraminal stenosis, these structures can become displaced, compressed, or distorted. The spinal nerve is located centrally and inferiorly in the mid-foraminal zone, positioned above the intervertebral disc level and between the superior and inferior pedicles. The sinovertebral nerve is situated in the upper anterior portion of the foramen near the posterior longitudinal ligament. The radicular artery follows the spinal nerve root, positioned in the superior anterior portion of the foramen near the vertebral body. The radicular vein runs along the posterior inferior portion of the foramen, adjacent to the spinal nerve. The intervertebral vein is positioned parallel to the intervertebral disc in the anterior inferior portion. If you remember the typical positions of the arteries and veins, you can anticipate the likelihood of vascular leakage during contrast studies in the subpedicular or infraneural approach. The infraneural approach is more likely to encounter intervertebral vein leakage, while the subpedicular approach is more likely to encounter spinal vein leakage. As your needle advances from the lateral to the central region, it encounters various ligamentous structures within the foraminal space, depending on the penetration depth. The intervertebral foramen is divided into three zones from central to lateral. Entrance zone, the medial portion near the spinal canal, close to the dura and spinal cord. Midforaminal zone, the middle portion of the foramen, where the dorsal root ganglion and spinal nerve are commonly located. Exit zone, the lateral portion near the pedicle, where the spinal nerve exits the foramen. During a transforaminal injection, the needle typically reaches the exit and mid-foraminal zones, targeting the spinal nerve and DRG. Reaching the entrance zone is challenging and potentially dangerous because of the proximity to the dura. During transforaminal needle placement, the needle may displace, stretch, or potentially tear the ligaments within the foramen as it advances toward the target area. Therefore, understanding the anatomy of the ligament is beneficial for comprehending the mechanical advantages of the transforaminal injection process. The foraminal ligaments stabilize the foraminal space and are distributed throughout the foramen. These include the transforaminal ligament in the mid portion, the superior corporotransverse ligament in the upper portion, and the inferior corporotransverse ligament in the lower part. These ligaments provide structural support but may contribute to foraminal stenosis when hypertrophied. As observed, various foraminal ligaments exist. During the subpedicular approach of transforaminal injection, the primary ligaments within the target area include the superior corporopedicular ligament, superior transforaminal ligament, and portions of the ligamentum flavum. In the infraneural approach, the inferior portion of the inferior corporopedicular ligament and inferior transforaminal ligament are frequently affected, often sustaining stretch out or tears. So, in addition to the anti-inflammatory effects of steroids on the nerve root and dorsal root ganglion, the mechanical manipulation of the needle may enhance the effectiveness of transforaminal injection. However, the contribution of mechanical stimulation of the transforaminal ligaments and the steroids' therapeutic effects varies depending on the severity of stenosis and the technical success of needle placement within the foraminal space. The degree of MRI grading of lumbar foraminal stenosis is useful for predicting the success rate of transforaminal needle placement and medication delivery. Transforaminal injection is typically effective in cases of grade 2, moderate foraminal stenosis, or less. In grade 2, there is a visible narrowing of the foramen with definite nerve root compression, often accompanied by deformation of the nerve root, although its signal intensity remains preserved. However, transforaminal needle placement becomes significantly more challenging in grade 3, severe foraminal stenosis. Grade 3 involves severe narrowing with complete obliteration of the perineural fat surrounding the nerve root, leading to significant compression and possible ischemic or inflammatory changes in the nerve root. Therefore, accurately interpreting the MRI grading of foraminal stenosis is essential for predicting the success rate of the transforaminal needle placement. So, I usually prioritize flavo injection as the first-line approach for severe grade 3 stenosis. From my perspective, grade 2 stenosis typically responds well to transforaminal injections. However, grade 3 stenosis often requires more advanced and combined treatment approaches due to the severity of compression and limited medication delivery. Currently, I combine transforaminal and flavo injections in cases of intractable pain to maximize therapeutic efficacy. For example, in cases of L4-5 foraminal and subarticular stenosis, which often coexist, a combination of injections such as L5 subpedicular, L4 infraneural, and L4-5 flavo-targeted injections can be employed to address the advantage of transforaminal and flavo injection. I previously discussed the benefits of flavo injection in central and foraminal stenosis. If you combine the knowledge of flavo injection with the advantages of transforaminal needle placement, your treatment approach will be significantly enhanced. In the next video, I will post several cases of combined transforaminal and flavo injection techniques. You will learn how to solve the challenging cases. Thank you for watching. It has been my honor to be with you. As esteemed premium members, your support greatly motivates my journey of practical pain management on YouTube. I look forward to seeing you in the upcoming videos.